from San Francisco, California. This is the Rock and Roll Geek Show.
This is the story of my rock and roll butler.
Michael Butler. I'm nervous as a son of a bitch. I apologize.
Hey, Michael.
I'm going to throw up.
Michael, can I say something before we start? There's a young lady here. Her name is Sierra McKenzie. Will you stand up, please? She just got a record deal. She's 17 years old. 17 years old. And I heard some of her music, and it's fantastic.
There's the future of music right there.
Her record's coming out on September 7th. Sierra, C-I-E-R-A, McKenzie. Watch out for her.
The future of music.
She's bad.
All right, Michael, go ahead.
When I was a kid, I was an angry, angry young man, like most little kids were in high school. And one song saved my life. It was called It's a Riot. And I drove down the street. I wanted to blow up my school. I would have been in jail right now. But I cranked up It's a Riot from fucking Stars, man. And it saved me from killing everybody at my school. And these guys, Joe X Doobie and Brendan Harkin. There's a lot of Kiss podcasts here, and they probably know Stars from Bill Coin Management. But if you don't know Stars, friends, you need to go out and get all four of those Stars albums because it's four of the greatest albums ever made.
That's what I'm talking about.
Keep talking, Mark.
When we were kids, we didn't have internet, we didn't have MTV, and the only way to find good bands was looking in Cream and Circus and Rock Scene magazine, and there was an ad, full page ad, of this big chrome Tama drums kit, and it said Joe X Doobie of Stars, and I had to go buy the Stars album just from looking at that ad. You put Tama drums on the map, didn't you, Joe X Doobie?
I was one of the first people that was able to use Tama in the United States.
They were a Japanese drum?
New Japanese company, but their technology and craftsmanship was second to none. I still play them today. I still play Tama.
Also, you told me that, I don't know if you know anything about drum sets, but the cymbal stands, like if the cymbals go,
like
they're called boom stands.
Like that these one. Things. Huh?
Joe X Doobie invented the boom stand. A lot of people don't know that. How did you make the boom stand?
Well, it's a mother of invention. It was necessity. I wanted to bring the cymbals in towards me playing a big kit, but there was no ability to do that. So I took the top of a microphone stand like this and substituted the top of a cymbal stand, and I stuck it in this piece, put a cymbal on it, and then turned
like
a straight mic stand, a straight drum cymbal stand into a boom stand using this part right here from an Atlas boom stand.
How did, so did Stars come before Kiss or after Kiss?
Kiss was already going along pretty good by the time we showed up.
Was O'Coin looking for another act, or did you already know Bill O'Coin?
O'Coin had launched Kiss, and Kiss was, when we joined with O'Coin, Kiss Alive, their first live album was just ready to come out. And so they had done their first few albums. Richie was a big Kiss fan when they first appeared. Brendan and I didn't know him so much. But we got to know him by being with O'Coin up at the office, and we got to be friends and colleagues after that.
Did you guys ever play on, like, did you ever tour with Kiss?
Well, not often.
No, we did a couple gigs with Kiss. I think they wanted to keep us, you know, not competing with them quite so much. And I think we only did maybe three gigs with them, right?
Yeah, I can only remember less than a half a dozen. And the reason is, let's say you're out playing a gig and you have a problem or something. Well, you tell your manager to go yell at the headliner. And if your manager manages the headliner, then you got nothing you can do. So we purposely did not play with them also so that we didn't get too much of the obvious comparison of, you know, being called. We didn't want to be called Little Kiss or Kiss Junior or any of that stuff.
I want to back it up a little bit. So before Stars, there was a band called The Looking Glass, and that song, The Sailor Said Brandy, you're a fire. Two of you guys were in Looking Glass, Peter Swevel, the bass player.
Myself and Peter were in the original Looking Glass, and that's what morphed in eventually into Stars.
So you probably had money from that tune.
Oh, tons of it.
Really? So you're loaded. You didn't need to be here.
Tons of money.
And the other band that they were formed out of was a band called Stories.
Richie,
that was
it?
Brother Louie. Louie.
Stories and Looking Glass were contemporaries. We actually knew them from when we neither of us had nothing.
And the great Michael Lee Smith was in which band?
Michael Lee was in a band down in Atlanta. I don't know what it was, but he was in something down there.
Did he join Looking Glass or Stories?
When Michael Lee Smith joined Looking Glass when the original lead singer from Looking Glass, Elliot Lurie, decided that he wanted to go on a solo career. We put an ad in the back of the Village Voice and hired Michael Lee Smith. Brendan was already in the band by that point. We had Brendan playing guitar in Looking Glass, and he was with us for a while.
And so then the two bands eventually became the band that became Stars. Were you guys called Stars from the beginning? No, it was Fallen Angels, right?
Well, Looking Glass then morphed into the band Fallen Angels, and we did another album on Arista. That a couple of singles were released. They went nowhere. And then we then morphed again into Stars once we acquired Richie Romano.
How did the record deal get from Capitol Records? First of all, what do you think about Capitol Records?
Well, I mean, hey, it's the record company of the Beatles. What's to complain about, right?
So Stars gets a record deal with Capitol. Everything's great. We're on our way. Capitol Records, the label that the Beatles signed us, Stars. We are going to be huge.
Yeah. I mean, we were along for the ride. It was great. You know, there were complaints about it later that maybe they weren't really as into a hard rock band as they should have been or could have been. And they were based in California. Stars was a New York band, so it's not like we could really hang out with the people that worked there that much. And that's a big deal. You know, if you can make friends with the people at the record company and have a kind of a social relationship with people that you're in business with, it's a strong connection. Remember that. The social connection is a real strong connection. And, you know, we were a continent away from them. So I think that hurt us a little bit, but I mean, there's worse things in the world than being signed to Capitol Records, I'll tell you that, you know.
I'll tell you, by the time I got to Capitol Records, it was my third major label.
So you're already a seasoned veteran.
I was on CBS, on Epic. I was on Arista when it became Arista Records, formerly Bell Records. I was one of the few people I can think of that was signed by Clive Davis twice. And then Capitol after that. So Capitol Records was not my first time to the rodeo.
Did you guys get a fat advance from Capitol?
We all took our money and we went down to the Bahamas.
What's that?
We went down to the Bahamas.
Oh, really? You wasted all the advance?
Took all the money and went on a vacation.
So then A Coin had to finance the recording?
Say it again?
Did Bill A Coin have to finance the recording?
You mean the first record?
Yeah, for the first record.
No, they got money from Capitol.
Okay, so but you didn't use the money to go to the Bahamas. Okay.
Capitol put in a lot of money, and O'Coin put in a lot of money, too.
Yeah.
But, you know, O'Coin signed a production agreement with Capitol Records, and we were actually signed to O'Coin. I don't think, you know, I might be wrong about it, but I don't think we ever signed a contract personally with Capitol Records. It's like Rocksteady Management or O'Coin Management had a contractual agreement with Capitol, and we had a contractual agreement with them. So whatever money they could get from Capitol was great. Whatever they felt like they needed over and above that, you know, Bill had a lot of money at that point, and he put quite a bit of his own money into it. So, you know, money's that funds are fungible. So, where it came from, who knows?
But back then, record labels gave a band like four records to break.
They
would give a band four records. Can we turn up the monitors a little bit? They would give a band four records to be a success. To go nowadays, if the first album isn't a success in a month, you're dropped. So times were a little bit different. So if labels didn't give bands four albums to succeed or fail back then, we wouldn't have got the first four Stars albums. How'd the first album do?
It did well, but it, you know, you got to remember, Stars was during the time of Foreigner, Boston, Van Halen.
And Stars had just as good a tune
maybe,
as any
maybe
of them.
Just like a little soon before then, but no, not really. I think our first album came out and Boston's record was out, and maybe even Foreigner's first record. And for the first time, rock bands were selling multi-million records. I mean, not, you know, even Beatles records prior to that, eventually they sold however many, many, many millions. But it's not like a record came out and immediately it sold 4 or 5 million records. But Boston, I think I might be wrong about it, but I think Boston was one of the first bands to just go, pow. And so if we sold a few hundred thousand records, which is a lot of damn records, when you compare it to 5 million records, it's like, okay, so what else you got, you know? So it did well enough for everybody to say, okay, good. We had an album in the top 100. I don't know, even if it was in the 70s or something like that. We had a couple singles that did pretty good.
What was the single from the first album?
Fallen Angel, I think, was the first single, right?
She's Just a Fallen Angel. Great song. And Detroit Girls was probably a...
I don't know. Did we have a second single off the first album?
I don't know. We had asked Capitol if they would release, and we insisted that they release Pull the Plug as a single, because that was during the time that that whole Karen Ann Kringlin episode was happening, and they didn't have the balls to do it.
And you made a video from Don Kirshner's rock concert with She's Just a Fallen Angel and Pull the Plug, right?
Yeah.
We did,
Monkey Business.
Monkey Business.
Yeah, we did Monkey Business.
After that album, how long from that album till Violation? Was it like a next year? Because you did an album tour, a yearly cycle?
Yeah, we did Violation
the next year
and a half later.
And that was a, quote, concept album, right?
Didn't start out to be one, but it kind of turned into one during the recording
process. Was this Michael Eastness' idea for it to be a concept album?
I think he just started discovering that a few tunes started to relate to one another, and it wasn't conscious at first, but after he started coming up with a few tunes that had themes that were related to each other, by accident, he thought, okay, this could go someplace. And there's still a couple songs on the record, like All Night Long. That doesn't have anything to do with anything. It's just a really good song.
What was the concept of the album?
It was kind of like a futuristic,
It was a
post-apocalyptic record.
Yeah, it was just after World War III. The Earth, or the world was being destroyed. A new order had come into place.
And rock and roll was illegal.
So our protagonist of the album is this hoodlum kid who goes around attacking people on the subways and stuff.
In subway terror.
And then one day he finds he goes to the secondhand store and he finds a copy of Aerosmith's Walk This Way, and he listens to it and he realizes that emotion exists and love is in the air. And he goes back and he tells his girlfriend, Cherry, about this, that this is something that he wants to share with her. Well,
so is that the lyrics of Cherry Baby, him telling his girlfriend about this record he found?
Now the society is ruled by the committee, and the committee provides everything for you, and they give you your rent, and they give you your food and stuff, but you don't diss the committee. And if you do, then they steady your ass on up. So it's a violation to go against the committee. And if you fuck with them, then you get electroshock and they send you to Buffalo.
I want to rock and roll. No,
no,
that's a violation.
Can't do it.
I want to lose control.
Nope. No, can't do that.
I want to have some fun.
Baby, that's what
I want to love someone.
I ain't gonna happen. Better not try it.
That's right.
It was easy to write about a kid that was kind of shell-shocked at the time, because that was us.
So how does, is that a street light or the moon fit into that concept?
That's when he kind of comes out of his treatment, and he just doesn't know what's going on in the world. And he just
is it December or is it June? Is that the street light or the moon? That's my favorite Stars tune.
Well, after he got his ass steady, by the way,
stands
for the steps towards the eventual acceptance of disciplined youth.
How about that? I never knew that.
That's a mouthful.
Going to steady your ass on up, brother.
Say that again? Steps towards...
Steps towards the eventual acceptance of disciplined youth.
Huh. How about that?
And so our protagonist got his ass steadied on up. And after that, he was just a blithering idiot. Couldn't tell if it was a streetlight or the moon.
See, nowadays, this might sound like a little bit of a cheesy concept, or maybe not, but when I was a kid, that was no cheesy concept. That was superhero shit when I was a kid.
I think it's still a movie. I really do. I think it's absolutely a movie.
So, Cherry Baby was probably the biggest hit for Stars at the time.
That it was. Bigger That's the biggest the single album. We ever had, yeah.
Then you had to really step it up after Violation because you were a little bit farther with Cherry Baby, and that was a super pop song. So you had to be even more commercial. So you came out with an album called Attention Shoppers.
Well, you have to remember that we didn't have to do anything. If you remember, Stars came out of pop bands.
That's right.
Looking Glass and Stories. So doing hummy songs with melodies and singing and, you know, harmony and good writing was, that's where we came from. And so we just, you know, we would veer back and forth between playing really heavy stuff and playing, you know, songs that were pretty hummable.
And on the album cover for Attention Shoppers, which, by the way, it was in a brown paper bag, right? No, the inner sleeve was a brown paper bag. The outside of the album cover was a man and a woman walking down the street looking in a store window, and there's you guys in the store window.
Buy me. Buy me. At that point, we really felt like pieces of meat.
And I think in Rolling Stone magazine called you guys like selling out or something because you're...
Well, we knew that we were a commodity.
It wasn't the right thing to do, but we made it for you, Michael, because
I appreciate
we knew that in the future you were the kid that was shell-shocked and was going to need a record like that.
I was going to shoot my school up if I didn't hear the next album. So that album didn't do what you had hoped to do. So, Brendan, you eventually left the band?
Yeah, I left the band, started sitting in the Broadway pit and playing Broadway shows and doing guitar sessions in New York City. And Peter, the bass player, also left at the time. And so the three remaining members got two new guys they had known and liked and good players. And they made Coliseum Rock, which is a record you just played.
No, Doobie, I heard that you were offered the gig in The Who after Keith Moon died.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
That true?
Yes. And I wanted to stay with Stars because that was my band.
Because Attention Shoppers was going to be huge.
Attention Shoppers was going to finally put us over the top.
He turned down The Who gig for Stars. Pretty good choice.
They were going to require Doobie to do a lot of really crazy things and, you know, a lot of drugs and throw televisions out of windows and stuff. And he said, I just can't do that.
I think it was a good choice.
He turned down the gig.
Stars.
You know? The money didn't have anything to do with money, really. Right, Doob?
You know, Brendan, I'm a little shy, but, you know, I tried my best.
Yeah.
So then, after you left, Brendan, they put out Coliseum Rock, which was the last of the Capitol records.
And I had nothing to do with it. But it's a great record.
The single for Coliseum Rock was called So Young, So Bad.
Which is the title of a movie from the 50s starring Anne Francis that Michael saw one night on TV and just became absolutely enamored with. He fell in love with Anne Francis and how the fact that you could be so young and so bad.
I called the radio station about 50 times a day and disguised my voice. I would call, hi, can you play So Young, So Bad from Stars? And then I call back 10 minutes later, hi, can you play So Young, So Bad? And I call, after about 50 times calling, the DJ says, no, I'm not going to play it and stop calling here. But I kept calling anyway. They eventually played it.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. I did everything I could for it to be a hit.
Well, and that was yeoman's work. Thank you.
I think you left at the wrong time, Brendan, because that album is great. That album, top to bottom, is as good, just song-wise, every song is great on it. And the Coliseum, the guitar thing that I played when we were coming up here, pre-eruption.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
They get Eddie Van Halen was a Stars fan?
Well, we knew, we had been told that Van Halen, too, was Stars fans as well.
Yeah, there you go. Who cited Stars as a major influence? Rattle off some of the big bands. Bon Jovi.
Metallica.
Motley Crue.
Poison, Rat.
But not one of those assholes could record a Stars tune.
Not yet.
You think they'll someday? I'll bet they don't.
It'll happen.
I think Jay-Z is going to record. He's a big Stars fan. I think he's going to record.
And 50 fan. Cent. Yeah, and 50 Cent is like a huge Stars fan. He told me.
Eminem, he's a Stars fan.
He told me. He gave me this jacket. 50 Cent gave me this jacket.
Hillary Clinton's a Stars fan. Who knew? You know? She plays guitar. She's pretty damn good.
There's a guy in the audience here wearing a Stars shirt. I think he has a question. Come up here, guy.
Yes, come on up here, young man. Yes, young fella.
Yeah.
Sit down.
Hello.
What's your name? Where are you from?
I am Jason Thomas Broderick. I am from Cottontown, Tennessee, about 30 miles north of Nashville. I got a little store out there. I sell records and give guitar lessons.
I would have never guessed you were from the South.
Huh?
I would have never guessed you were from the South.
How could you tell?
Sound like, all right, go
ahead. I'm trying to hide it, but I guess
What's
I'm not.
What's your question?
My question is, personally, I think Stars are more famous and more known now in 2018 and a couple years ago than maybe they were in the 70s. I've had a lot of fans turn me on to Stars, and I've turned them on to Stars. And young people, like early 20s, teens, where they just get on YouTube and they look at one band and then they find another band that sounds similar. So, you know, we had to like... When we were young, we were lucky to have a magazine article about of a band. You know, we didn't have nothing, and we had to ask our uncles and aunts, "Hey, have you ever heard of Stars?" And you know, they're like, "Oh, I saw them open for Peter Frampton and stuff like that." But we didn't really know. And it's like with the internet, I almost think y'all might be more famous now than ever. And
is that
I
your just, question?
Yeah, I just kind of wanted to know if y'all noticed. Like there's a bigger fan base now than back then, or is it the same?
Let me take that one. I don't think there are more people that know about us, but the people that you know, there are more people within that.
Yeah.
As a percentage, but you don't see Stars today playing to 20,000 people.
Right.
You don't remember those days. I mean. Stars played to 80,000 people indoors at the King Dome in Seattle.
Wow.
When it existed. It's no longer. But Stars played to 80,000 people indoors. And then typically summer festivals, that's, you know, there'd be 30,000, 40,000 people. So it's kind of hard to say that Stars is more well-known now. But it would be nice if one of the other bands recorded, you know, if Bon Jovi recorded a Star song, you might see Stars play to... start to headline 5,000-seat venues again, you know. I think it's just out of the people that come up to your store. And I've been there, and it's great. I go up to Cottontown. Is it Cottontown?
Yes, sir.
Cottontown, Tennessee, Jason's Groovy Record Room. Among those people, you know, most of them are Stars fans, right? And if they're not before they get there, they're there. They are after they leave.
Hey, I just play the records, and people go, "Who is that?" It's like they should have been bigger than Foreigner. They should have been bigger than Styx. They should have been bigger than who else? A lot of bands.
He's making
you know?
Me cry.
I mean, but the songs are there and they're incredible. And
they have
the
best frontman or one of the best frontmen of all time, in Michael E. Smith, and lyricist. The guy wrote brilliant lyrics.
Let me tell you, if I got into Shoulda, Coulda, Woulda, I'd be crazy. I'd be out of my mind. Thank you for
any
noticing.
Any bitterness at all?
Thank you for noticing.
But there's so many young people. It's in the Stars
now.
You
know what that is? I think it has to do with the authenticity of what you're hearing. Because Brenda and I were saying before, we used to record all of us in the room together. We'd be looking at one another, pounding it out. And it was a band playing as a band.
Right.
That doesn't happen anymore.
Nope.
It's pretty rare, if ever. And I think that comes across in the grooves.
It does.
And I think that you get that in how the music affects you emotionally. I really do.
Well, it's just good songwriting and good performances. Everybody was a great player. Michael Lee Smith, he's the first guy. Before David Lee Roth, there was Michael Lee Smith.
Oh, hell yeah.
You know?
Oh, hell
yeah. I mean, he had three names before anybody.
Any bad feelings, like any bitterness about not being as successful as you think you should have been?
Not for me.
What are you doing?
You have to move on or you go nuts.
So now in 2018, Brendan, you live in Nashville?
I live in Franklin, Tennessee, yep.
What are you doing nowadays?
I moved down here from New York about 25 years ago, and I'm a studio rat, basically. I was always the guy that loved being in the studio and had a pretty good career post-Stars as a studio player up in New York and Broadway Pit, doing a million jingles and playing on a lot of records. So when I moved down here, I started a studio. I bought a house that Emmylou Harris owned, had a little studio built on the side. I had a studio in New York for a little while. I started one up. And I've had a successful studio, Wildwood Recording, in Brentwood first and now in Franklin, Tennessee for over 25 years.
Wow.
And that's what I love to do. I don't even want to go out and do a gig anymore, you know?
The great Joe X. Doobie, what are you doing now? Stars still going to this
He's
day,
building
right?
bridges. Doobie's building bridges, literally.
I do. We still play as Stars when asked. Not often, but when asked, we do play as Stars. But when I finally left the music business about 1980 or so, I was very famous and very poor. So I started working as a construction worker for a number of years. I was a carpenter. For a couple of years, I did that, and then I realized that's hard work. I got to get an inside job. So I went back to school, and I got a degree. In 1985, I graduated, and I've been working. I'm a landscape architect. My specialty is designing. I'm a bridge designer. I design long-span bridges. Huh. I design parks in towns. I design campuses and city streets and urban spaces and stuff like that.
Well,
I work in Manhattan. I
could talk to you guys. He's a rock star in his spare time.
I could talk to you guys all day, but they're giving us the hook. So Joe X. Doobie and Brendan, thank you so much for coming on.
And thank y'all for the music.
Go out there in one of these vendors and look for the first four Stars albums. You will not be disappointed.
Yes, the first four Stars album. Everybody thinks Cheap Trick's so much great. I mean, I love Cheap Trick. And I love Foreigner, all these other bands. But they ain't got nothing on Stars. These guys have the songs.
You can't shut Jason up when he starts.
No, I love
start.
Stars.
You're just going to have to turn the volume down on the mic slowly. They'll still be talking about us.
I love them.
Thanks for coming, folks. Appreciate it very much.
Thank you much. Don't clap, but just encourage them.
It's a rock and roll geek train wreck.